بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين ونستغفر ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. بدأنا ولله الحمد والمنة في الدرس الماضي بدراسة أطول قسم في الكتاب وهو القسم التاسع. نعم،
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. So we began previously the studying the largest section of this book, and it is the ninth section.
وذكرنا أن المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى ذكر في هذا القسم المناهي اللفظية. نعم.
And we mentioned that in this section, the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he began by mentioning those words which are prohibited in the Sharia.
والألفاظ الشركية.
All those words which are a form of shirk.
وبعض الشركيات.
And also some forms of shirk.
يعني الأعمال الشركية.
Meaning actions of shirk.
وركز المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى في هذا القسم على كفر النعمة.
And also that the author, he concentrated on in this section كفر النعمة, a person rejecting the blessings.
والشرك الأصغر الخفي.
And also he concentrated on mentioning the hidden form of shirk, shirk الأصغر.
لماذا ركز المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى على كفر النعمة؟
Why did the author, may Allah mercy upon him, concentrate on the rejection of blessings?
ذكر هو رحمه الله أن شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى قال.
He mentioned that شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله said.
يقول هذا كثير في الكتاب والسنة.
That this is
يعني ذكر شكر النعمة وكفر النعمة كثير في الكتاب والسنة.
That in the book and the Sunnah, in the Quran and the Sunnah, we often find it being mentioned regarding accepting and showing gratitude for blessings and rejecting blessings.
وإذا كان كثير في الكتاب والسنة لابد أن يكون كثير عند الأئمة ومنهم هذا الإمام رحمه الله تعالى.
And if it is mentioned often in the Quran and the Sunnah, then similarly with these أئمة, with these great scholars, it must also be mentioned a lot.
يذم سبحانه.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he disdains
من يضيف إنعامه إلى غيره ويشرك به، نسأل الله عافية السلام، إما شرك أصغر أو شرك أكبر. يذم سبحانه من يضيف إنعام النعم إلى غيره.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he disdains those people who ascribe the blessings to other than Allah.
وذكرنا أن النعمة ابتلاء.
And we also mentioned that نعمة blessing is often a test.
والدليل على أن النعمة ابتلاء، كل نعمة أنعم الله سبحانه وتعالى بها عليك فهي ابتلاء.
So every single blessing which Allah blesses you with, then this is a test.
ونبلوكم بالشر والخير فتنة فلما رآه مستقرا عنده قال هذا من فضل ربي ليبلوني أشكر أم أكفر فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه رب. المهم أدلة كثيرة تدل على أن النعمة ابتلاء.
So there are many evidences in the Quran and the Sunnah showing us that نعمة blessings are a test.
وقلنا كيفية الخلاص والخروج من هذا.
And we also mentioned how a person can protect himself from this.
التعلق بالله لا بغيره قبل أن تأتي النعمة.
So the protection or the cure to this is either before the blessing or after the blessing. In terms of before the blessing comes, then firstly a person attaches himself to Allah, not to anybody besides him.
وقلنا هذا الذي يقع في ذهن بعض الناس أو يكون من وساوس الشيطان من أن البعض يفكر لو يتعرف عليه الوزير أو يعطيه التاجر أو الغني أو الملك أو كذا ويعطيه من ماله. نعم.
And we also mentioned the whisperings of shaitan to some people in that they imagine or they think that if only the king or the minister was to give me this amount of money.
الجنة لا تطلب إلا من الله.
So paradise is not sought except from Allah.
وكذلك الرزق لا يطلب إلا من الله.
And similar to this, a risk provisions are not sought except from Allah.
فقبل أن تأتي النعمة تتعلق بالله لا بغيره.
So therefore, before the blessings come to you, then you attach yourself to Allah, not other than Him.
وبعد أن تأتي النعمة تقوم بالشكر النعمة بالقلب واللسان والجوارح.
And after the blessing has come to you, then you show gratitude, a shukr for this ni'mah, for this blessing. And this is done in your heart, upon your tongue, and upon your limbs.
وقلنا الغالب في الناس نسأل العافية والسلامة.
And we said that the situation with most of the people, when we ask Allah for safety and pardoning,
أنه لا يتنبه حال السراء، يتنبه في حال الضراء، وقليل من عباده الشكور.
And we said that the situation with most of the people is that in times of ease and affluency, then they don't care, then they don't pay attention. But when it comes to times of difficulty and hardship, then they start paying attention to this.
بعد هذا ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى يعني أمثلة على كفر النعمة.
And then after this, the author رحمه الله he mentioned various examples or scenarios of people rejecting the blessings.
هذا بجدي واجتهادي.
So a person, for example, saying, "Oh, these blessings are due to my own struggling and my own working and me becoming tired."
قال وأنا محقوق به يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى يعلم أني أحق بهذا من غيري أو على علم من الله أني له أهل.
And also a person saying that I am deserving of this blessing, or a person saying that Allah knows that this blessing should have come to me. I am the one who is most deserving of it.
إنما أوتيته على علم. يقول أنا عندي علم وعندي حرفة وعندي ذكاء وفطنة أعرف كيف آتي بالمال.
Or a person says that this wealth or this blessing that has come to me is because of my intelligence, my academic brilliance, for example.
إنما ورثت هذا المال كابر عن كابر. يقول نحن عائلة يعني عائلة غنى نرث الأموال بعضنا عن بعض.
And also an example of kufr al-ni'ma, rejecting blessings, is for a person to say that we're a very rich family and this wealth that has come to me was inherited by me or given to me generation after generation.
نعم ثم ذكر ما يتعلق باتخاذ الند مع الله سبحانه وتعالى فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا شبراء ونظراء ومثلاء تصرفون لهم ما لا يصرف إلا لله من الدعاء والذبح والنذر وغير هذا.
And then after this, the author rahimahullah, he mentioned taking partners to Allah with Allah. And Allah said in the Quran, فَلَا تَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا, that do not create partners for Allah, i.e. partners, or those who resemble, or those who you think resemble Him, or those who you make equal to Him, i.e. in anything, whether it's a dua or any other form of worship.
وكذلك أن الحالف يؤكد الكلام الذي ذكر لك بذكر معظم لديك. وإذا حلف لك بالله إذا كنت معظم لله تصدق هذا إلا إذا كنت تعلم أنه كاذب 100% أو يغلب على الظن أنه كاذب. نعم.
And also then we studied or we discussed al-half, i.e. taking an oath or swearing or vowing by Allah. The one who takes an oath or the one who vows, he's taking an oath by something or somebody who you honor and exalt. And therefore if somebody comes and he takes an oath by Allah or he swears by Allah over something, then because you exalt and you honor Allah, then you accept this. Unless you know for 100% that he is lying. Otherwise you accept what he says because of this oath he has taken by the name of Allah.
فإذا كان إذا كنت تعلم أنه صادق أو يترجح صدق هذا تصدقه. وإلا وإذا تساوى الأمران كذلك تصدقه. يترجح كذبه. تعلم أنه كاذب هذا يكذب. نعم.
So if a person takes a vow by Allah, he swears by Allah upon something, if you know that this person is truthful, or it's most probable what he's saying is the truth, then you accept what he says. If you're not sure, or it's equal whether he's lying or he's telling the truth, you accept what he says. However, if you're sure, absolutely sure that this person is a liar and he's lying, then this person you can reject what he's saying.
كذلك حكم قول ما شاء الله وشئت أن ما شاء الله وشئت من الشرك الأصغر.
And then also the author rahimahullah he mentioned the ruling of a person saying ما شاء الله وشئت, whatever Allah willed and what you willed, and that he said that this is shirk asfar, a minor form of shirk.
لأن الواو تقتضي المساواة.
Because the واو here, the and ما شاء الله وشئت, the واو, the and, this indicates being equal.
فماذا تقول لمن قال لك ما شاء الله وشئت؟
So what should you say to a person who says to you whatever Allah willed and what you will?
تقول له أحسنت.
Do you say to him, yes, very good?
هكذا يخاطب الفضلاء مثلي.
This is the way, this is the manner in which virtuous people like me should be addressed.
لو قلت له هذا الكلام فأنت طاغوت.
If you say this type of statement to him, then you are a طاغوت, you are a false deity, you've propped yourself up to be a false deity.
تجيب هذا بما أجاب به النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام.
Rather, you should reply to this person with the reply that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to the person and said this to him.
أجعلتَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا.
That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, did you make me a partner or an equal to Allah?
بل ما شاء الله وحده.
Rather say Allah wills alone, whatever Allah wills alone.
ثم ذكرنا أن المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى ذكر كذلك ما يتعلق بالكلام على الدهر، وقلنا الكلام على الدهر أو سب الدهر ينقسم إلى ثلاثة أقسام.
And then after this, we discussed what the author said regarding speaking about time or lamenting against time. And we said that speaking regarding time, it can be divided into three categories.
نعم. سب الدهر، سب الزمن، سب الساعات، الليالي، الأيام، الدقائق، الأوقات. كل هذا يدخل في سب الدهر.
So when we talk about الدهر, insulting time or speaking against time, we're talking about a person, for example, insulting or lamenting days or minutes or hours or seasons or months or weeks, anything relating to time.
نعم. إذا اعتقد أن الدهر هو المؤثر بذاته وبيده جلب المنافع ودفع المضار فهذا الشرك أكبر.
So if a person believes that those periods of times themselves, they are the ones that affect and influence, they are the ones that bring about the harm and the good, then this is shirk akbar, major form of shirk.
إذا اعتقد أن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الآمر والمقلب والمصرف للدهر لكن يسب الدهر لأنه محل الشيء الذي يكره فهذا محرم وسفه ونقص في العقل.
However, if a person believes that it is Allah who controls the things and it is Allah who brings benefit and harm, however he insults the time or he laments the time because it is the time that it happened in, then this is muharram, this is something which is impermissible, and also it's a deficiency in a person's intellect, it's foolishness.
الثالث خبر محض يقول هذا اليوم شديد البرد شديد الحر. نعم.
And then you have a third situation whereby a person is merely informing, it's mere information. A person says, for example, today on this day it is very cold, on this day it is very warm.
هل الدهر من أسماء الله؟
Is الدهر from the names of Allah؟
لا يمكن أن يكون الدهر من أسماء الله لأن بهذا نجعل المخلوق خالقا. نعم.
It's not possible for الدهر, i.e. time, to be from the names of Allah because time is something which is created. And therefore, how can something which is created be from Allah?
والآية ترد هذا لأنه قال أنه أراد بهذه الآية الرد على معتقد الجاهلية أنه كان يعتقد في الجاهلية أن الزمن هو المؤثر بذاته. نعم.
So the ayah itself in the Quran it refutes this because it talks about the people of Jahiliyyah and that they used to believe that الدهر the time is the one that brings about good or benefit, and the Quran spoke against them.
فما معنى قول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عن الله سبحانه وتعالى وأنا الدهر؟ نعم.
حديث قدسي. So therefore, what is the meaning of the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he narrated a hadith قدسي that Allah سبحانه وتعالى said أنا الدهر؟
أي مقلبه ومصرفه والآمر له. خلاص اشرح أحسن.
So the meaning of
أن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الآمر والمقلب والمصرف للدهر والدهر مخلوق ليس له قدرة ولا اختيار والله سبحانه وتعالى هو الذي يأمر الدهر. نعم.
So the wording of the hadith is that Allah says I am time. The meaning of this is I am the one who controls the time, who affects the time, who organizes the time.
نعم. طيب هذا الذي يعني مر بنا في الدرس الماضي ولله الحمد والمنة. نعم.
So this is everything we covered in the previous lessons and for Allah's all praise.
ثم جاء المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى باب النهي عن التسمي بقاضي القضاء. نعم.
So then after this the author he came with a chapter which is the prohibition of somebody calling himself قاضي القضاة. The judge of all of the judges.
قاضي القضاء حاكم الحكام ملك الملوك حتى ولو كان هذا بغير اللغة العربية كما يقال بالفارسية شاهان شاه مثلا. نعم.
So similar words to this or similar expressions and phrases to this. A person saying somebody is the judge of all judges, the king of all kings, the ruler of all of the rulers, even if this is in other than the Arabic language, like for example in Persian they say
Shahan Shah.
They say Shan Shah. which means like the king of all of the kings or the masters of all of the masters.
يعني سواء كان باللغة العربية أو باللغة الإنجليزية أو بالفارسية أو بالأردية أو بأي لغة, لأن الذي يكون قاضي على كل قاضي هو الله سبحانه وتعالى. هذا تعدي على جانب الربوبية وهذا محرم. نعم.
So this is regardless of whatever language it is, whether it's Arabic or Persian or Urdu or English, a person saying that this person, he is the judge of all of the judges. The one who is the judge of all of the judges, it is Allah. And therefore by using these expressions, this is an insult to Allah in terms of his rububiyyah.
نعم, وهو محرم.
And it is محرم, haram.
لأن هذا من المناهي اللفظية.
Because this is from those words or those expressions which have been prohibited.
ولو نوى وقصد أن هذا قاضي حتى على الله سبحانه وتعالى, هذا أكبر, كفر أكبر.
And if a person by saying this, the judge of all judges and the king of all kings, he means that this person is above Allah in his judgment, then this is kufr akbar, a major form of kufr, disbelief.
لكن يصح أن يقيد هذا, يقول مثلا قاضي قضاة القرن السابع ابن حجر العسقلاني رحمه الله, يصح لأن قضاء الله سبحانه وتعالى يتقيد لا بزمان ولا بمكان ولا بطائفة. نعم.
But it's permitted to use these words, or say for example قاضي القضاة, the judge of the judges, and then restrict it to a particular place or a time frame. For example, they say Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he was the judge of the judges in the 7th century, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the judge of all the judges, then it isn't restricted by a time frame or a place. And therefore, if somebody was to restrict it by a time or a place, then this is permitted.
لكن الأولى ترك هذا.
But it is better for a person to leave it.
لأنه لعل يعني بعد فترة مع كثرة الاستعمال لا يذكر التقييد. نعم.
Because it's better to leave it altogether, because maybe after a while or after an amount of time, a period of time, then people stop using this restriction. They stop saying in the 7th century. They just say that he is the judge of the judges.
نعم. كذلك ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى ما يتعلق بأسماء الله. أسماء الله سبحانه وتعالى تنقسم إلى قسمين. نعم.
And then after this, the author, may have mercy upon him, he mentioned that which relates to the names, to the names of Allah. And the names of Allah are divided into two categories.
أسماء مختصة بالله سبحانه وتعالى لا يصح أن يسمى بها أحد كائنا من كان. نعم.
So there are certain names of Allah that are specific for Allah alone. Nobody is allowed to be named with these names, whoever he is.
Allah.
So for
والرحمن ورب العالمين.
So for example, the name Allah, this is specific for Allah. The name Ar-Rahman, which means the one who has the most amount of mercy, this is specific for Allah. The term رب العالمين, the Lord of the worlds or the Lord of the universe, then this is specific for Allah.
إذا ما يمكن أن يسمى أحد بهذه الأسماء, لأن هذه أسماء مختصة بالله سبحانه وتعالى. وإن سمي بها أحد وجب أن يغير. نعم.
And therefore, it's not possible for a person to be called by these names alone. I.e., we can't call somebody, for example, Ar-Rahman. And if a person is named with this name, then the obligation is to change the name of this person.
الثاني أسماء غير مختصة بالله سبحانه وتعالى يصح التسمي بها على أنها أسماء يعني دون قصد الصفة. سيأتي بالمثال.
And then the second type of names, the names of Allah, are those names which aren't specific to Allah alone. And these types of names, a person can use for other people. A person can name other people with these names. However, he names other people with these names because they are mere names, not because of the attribute behind this name.
فإن قصد بهذه الأسماء الوصف الذي لا يكون إلا لله, منعنا أيضا كذلك التسمي بها.
So if a person intends by naming a person with these names of Allah which can be applied to other people, that he intends the attribute which Allah has, then we also prohibit him from doing this.
قصة يوسف عليه الصلاة والسلام مع عزيز مصر. هذا عزيز, سمي العزيز وكريم. نعم.
So the story of Yusuf عليه السلام with Aziz of Egypt.
العزيز بالنسبة لأسماء الله عزة قدر وقهر وغلبة، وهو العزيز فلن يرام جنابه أن يرام جناب ذي السلطان، وهو العزيز الغلاب لم يغلبه شيء، هذه صفتان، وهو العزيز بقوة هي وصفه، فالعز حينئذ ثلاث معاني.
So the meaning of عزيز
عزة قدر وقهر وغلبة، عزة قدر وقهر وغلبة، هو العزيز فلن يرام جنابه أن يرام جناب ذي السلطان، وهو العزيز الغلاب لم يغلبه شيء، هذه صفتان لا يمكن أحد أن يغلب الله سبحانه وتعالى، وهو العزيز بقوة هي وصفه، فالعز حينئذ ثلاث معاني، عزة قدر وقهر وغلبة. في القدر يعني في أن الله سبحانه وتعالى له قدر لا يمكن أن يماثل أحد من مخلوقاته، عزة قدر وقهر لا يستطيع أحد أن يغلب الله سبحانه وتعالى، والله غالب على أمره، وعز قدر وقهر وغلبة. نعم.
So the king of that time, at the time of Yusuf, he was also called Aziz. However, when we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we use his name Al-Aziz,
Aziz مصر هذا يعني وزير مفهوم أو ملك أو كذا، هذه عزة قاصرة، فيصح أن يسمي العزيز، ذق إنك أنت العزيز الكريم، لكن إذا نوى الوصف الذي لا يكون إلا لله بالعزيز هذا منعنا من التسمي. الحكيم تسميه حكيم، فهل يصح أن تسمي إنسان حكيم؟ نعم، أحد الصحابة يسمى بحكيم بن حزام، لكن الصحابة هنا في الحديث عندما قصدوا به أبو الحكم، لأنه كان إذا اختلف قومه في شيء قضى بينهم فرضي كل الفريقين، قالوا أنت أبو الحكم يعني دائما يرضى، هذا ما يمكن يكون إلا لله، منع هنا من التسمي. نعم.
The meaning of Aziz when he was relating to the person at the time of Yusuf alayhi salam is that he was a minister, or he was a king, or he was a prince. And therefore Aziz means somebody who has a position of authority or greatness to a certain level. However, this is restricted and deficient. As for the meaning of Al-Aziz, when it refers to the name of Allah, when it is the name of Allah, then this is that Allah is Al-Aziz in his qadr, in his extent, and his ghalaba, in how he is victorious and nobody can be victorious over Allah, and also in his qahr, his power and his might. So that this is the meaning of Al-Aziz when it relates to Allah, that he has Al-Izzah, he has his greatness and his might and his power in terms of his ghalaba, his victory over other people, nobody can be victorious over him, and also his qadr, that his extent, how powerful and mighty and great he is in his extent, and also his might itself and his power itself. Also, we have another name, Hakim. And Hakim means somebody who has wisdom. So we can name a person
Hakim.
And the meaning of Hikmah, wisdom, is a person placing everything in its appropriate and correct place. So we can name other people with Hakim. And we have a Sahabi who was called
Hakim ibn Hizam.
Hakim ibn Hizam. So this was his name. But the
لم يقصد به الوصف.
But this
قصد به الاسم. يصح. عزيز مصر قصد به الاسم. نعم. لكن عندما قصد هنا في الحديث الوصف الذي لا يكون إلا لله منعنا كذلك من التسمي. نعم.
So these names, Aziz and Hakim, of the minister and also the companions, then this is just intending the mean alone, the name alone, not the meaning and the actual attribute of Allah behind the name. As for this hadith in the chapter, then there's a person called Abu al-Hakam. And whenever the people, they differed in anything, then they would go to this person, and then he would judge between them, and they would become happy with his judgment. Until a time came when they started calling him Abu al-Hakam, i.e. the father of the rulings, for example, or the person who's always correct in his rulings. So because of this now, because of them intending the attribute behind this name, then it was an obligation to change his name.
نعم. إذن مرة أخرى. إذا قصد بهذا الاسم الوصف الذي لا يكون إلا لله منعنا من التسمي وإلا فهو جائز. نعم. هذا في القسم الثاني أسماء غير مختصة بالله سبحانه وتعالى.
So once again, in the second type of names, which are for Allah, but they are not restricted to Him or specific for Him, other people can be named with these names. if a person intends by this name, just the name itself, then this is permitted. If, however, he intends by this name, by calling this person this name, the attribute behind the name, which is for Allah, then we prevent this name being named.
أما النوى أو سمى الله سمى أحد من المخلوقين بأسماء مختصة لله سبحانه وتعالى هذا لا يصح كالله والرحمن ورب العالمين نعم.
And as for a person naming the people with names which are restricted and specific to Allah, then this isn't correct and this isn't permissible. Like for example calling people Allah or Ar-Rahman or رب العالمين.
ونبه الشيخ بن عثيمين رحمه الله تعالى في الشرح في هذا الباب أن التكني مباح. التكني مباح. لا على ما يظن بعض الناس أنه مستحب. نعم.
And Sheikh
الكنية هي ما يعني كان يبتدئ بأبو أو أم. نعم.
And Sheikh بن عثيمين رحمه الله he mentioned in his explanation of this chapter that a person having a kunya like a kunya, i.e. a name or a forename or a nickname which starts with Abu or something, then this is something which is mubah, this is merely permissible. Some people think that this is something which is recommended. However, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen explains that this is something which is just permitted, not recommended.
والذي يقول أن التكني مستحب يأتي بالدليل على استحباب التكني. نعم.
And as for the person who claims that having a kunya is something which is mustahab, something which is recommended, then he needs to bring the evidence for this.
لأن هذا حكم شرعي والحكم الشرعي يحتاج إلى دليل من الكتاب والسنة الصحيحة. نعم.
Because a person saying that something is mustahab, then this is a ruling of the Sharia, and a ruling of the Sharia must have an evidence.
ثم ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى باب مهم جدا وهو الاستهزاء والسخرية واللعب بماذا؟ بأحق الحق. قل أبي الله وآياته الشرعية والكونية ورسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام يشمل جميع الأنبياء والرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام نعم.
And then after this the author mentioned a very important and a very a dangerous aspect or a very important chapter and this is the chapter or the subject of mocking istihza mocking i.e. a person mocks something from the religion and Allah said in the Quran أَبِاللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ that where you كنتم تستهزئون
يعني ما بقي أن تلعب وتسخر وتستهزئ وتأتي بقصص ونكت إلا على أحق الحق أبي الله وآياته الشرعية والكونية ورسولي كنتم تستهزئون لا تعتذروا قد كفرتم أي كفر أكبر بعد إيمانكم من السلام عليكم السلام نعم
that Allah said in the Quran that was it Allah who used to mock was it the ayat of Allah whether it's the legislative signs of Allah in the Quran or the Sunnah or whether it's the universal signs of Allah or was it a messenger any messenger from amongst the messengers was it did he used to mock them meaning was there nothing left for you to joke about and to mock except that you have to mock Allah or his signs or his messenger or his messengers then Allah said after this قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ that you have disbelieved you have disbelieved with a major form of disbelief after your iman we ask Allah for safety and pardoning
الكفر ينقسم إلى قسمين
so kufr disbelief it is characterized in, it is categorized into two categories
كفر إعراض بأن لا يدخل في هذا الدين لكن لا يسب ولا يشتم ولا يتعرض لهذا الدين بالمحاربة نعم
so we have the first type which is kufr إعراض Which means a person, he turns away from the religion. He doesn't accept the religion in the first place. He doesn't enter into the religion in the first place. But at the same time, he doesn't insult or wage a war or criticize the religion. He just doesn't accept it in the first place.
كما حدث من أبي طالب لم يحارب هذا الدين. لم يدخل في الدين ولم يحارب. نعم.
Just as was the case with Abu Talib. He didn't enter into the religion, but at the same time, He never waged a war against religion. He never used to insult the religion.
الكفر الثاني كفر معارضة. لا يدخل في الدين لكن يبذل غاية جهده في محاربة هذا الدين بالسب والشتم ودفع الأموال وغير هذا. نعم. كما حدث من أبي لهب. نعم.
And then we have another type of kufr, the second type of kufr, which is kufr المعارضة, meaning a person neither does he accept and enter into the religion, but at the same time, he tries his utmost and he strives to speak against religion and tries to destroy the religion and wages a war against religion, spends his wealth against al-Islam, like the, just as the case was with Abu Lahab.
فالذي يسب الرب يستهزئ بدين الله يسب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا كفر كفر معارضة مثل ما حدث من أبي جهل وأبي لهب.
So the person who
insults هذا أعظم الكفر.
So the person who insults Allah and the person who mocks and jokes about the religion of Allah and the person who insults or mocks the Messenger of Allah, then this is from the second type of kufr, kufr المعارضة. And this was the disbelief, similar to the disbelief of Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl.
بعض الناس يقول في الذي يسب يقول هذا جاهل لا يدري أن سب الرب كفر أكبر.
So some people say regarding a person who insults Allah, insults the religion of Allah, they say this person is ignorant. He doesn't know what it means to insult Islam or insult Allah.
سبحان الله إذا كان لا يعرف أن سب الرب كفر إذا ماذا يعرف في دين الله؟
If this person doesn't know that insulting the Lord is not correct, then what does he know about this religion?
هذا ما يمكن يجهله أحد. نعم.
So this isn't something which anybody can possibly be ignorant over.
وقد يقول بعض الناس أنه هذا عندما يسب يسب وهو غضبان.
And some people might say that when this person is insulting the Lord, that he's only doing it out of anger, in a state of anger.
Subhanallah. لماذا عندما يغضب هذا لا يسب والده مثلا أو العشيرة أو القبيلة أو لا يسب الرئيس بل لا يتجرأ أن يسب أدنى شرطي أو رجل من هذه الدولة لأنه فيه سجن.
So this person, when he's in a state of anger, he becomes angry, then why doesn't he insult his own father, or insult his family, or insult his tribe? Or why doesn't he insult the leader? In fact, he wouldn't dare to insult the lowest ranking police officer. Why? Because he knows that if he was to do this, he'd be entered into prison.
هل تجد واحد من اليهود والنصارى يسب موسى أو عيسى عليهم الصلاة والسلام?
Do you ever find a single Jew or a Christian ever insulting موسى عليه السلام وعيسى عليه السلام؟
تجد هذا؟
Do you ever find this?
لكن تجد هذا في من يدعي الإسلام وبعد هذا يقول مسلم وهناك من يدافع عنه من المسلمين.
But you find this amongst the Muslims, or you find this amongst those people who claim Islam, and then other people come and they defend this person.
ثم بعض الناس يقول لهذا عندما يسب الرب يقول له كيف قلبك؟ قال مطمئن بالإيمان. قال سب الرب ولا إشكال.
And then other people, they say to this person, they say that when you're insulting the Lord, how do you find your heart? What are you feeling in your heart? Are you tranquil in your heart? And if he says, yes, I'm tranquil in my heart, they say, okay, carry on insulting and there's no problem.
طيب لماذا لو هذا سبك أنت وسب والدك وسب كذا ماذا تقول له؟ تقول تقصدني أو لا تقصدني؟ هل أنت غضبان أو قد تقتله أصلا عندما يسب؟ لكن عندما يسب الرب لا يتحرك أحد.
So how would the case be that if he was to insult your father or insult your mother, would you say to him, what do you mean by this when you're insulting? Are you tranquil? Are you not tranquil? How's your heart feeling? Nobody would say this. Rather, you might even end up killing him. But when it comes to insulting the Lord, insulting Allah, then nobody moves, nobody says anything.
الذي يسمع السب أو الاستهزاء بالرب بالدين بالأنبياء والرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام. نعم.
Those people who listen to or those who hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being mocked, being insulted or mocked, or mocking of the religion or mocking of the messenger,
إما أن ينكر أو يخرج من المجلس ينصرف. نعم.
Either the person should speak against it and reject it, or he leaves the sitting.
إذا بقي.
As for if he stays in that sitting or stays listening to the person,
ولم ينكر ولم ينصرف,
and he doesn't reject and speak against it, or he doesn't leave,
هو مثل الساب والمستهزئ,
then he is similar to the one who is insulting and similar to the one who is mocking.
كافر. كفر أكبر
كافر.
وقد نزل على الدليل وقد نزل عليكم في الكتاب إذا سمعتم آيات الله يكفر بها ويستهزأ بها فلا تقعدوا معهم حتى يخوضوا في حديث غيره إنكم إذا مثلهم. تحذر إخواننا، ما يمكن تسمع السب والاستهزاء تسكت، تستطيع إنكار تنكر، لا تستطيع تخرج من المجلس. كيف لو سب والدك أو كذا أو أحد من أقاربك، والله ما تستطيع أن تبقى وتسكت، فكيف بمن يسب الرب سبحانه وتعالى؟ نعم. وقد نزل عليكم في الكتاب.
And Allah says in the Quran that it has been revealed to you in the book.
أن إذا سمعتم آيات الله يكفر بها ويستهزئ بها.
That if you hear of the ayat of Allah being mocked, being insulted or mocked and joked about.
فلا تقعدوا معهم.
Then do not sit with them.
حتى يخوضوا في حديث غير، يعني يتكلموا في غير هذا، في غير السب.
Until they start speaking about something else, something totally different.
ما النتيجة؟ إنكم إذا مثلهم.
And what is the result of staying with them and sitting with them? That you are then similar to them.
الآن في رمضان.
Now in Ramadan.
تجد أنه في رمضان يجتهد شياطين الإنس.
You find in Ramadan that the shayateen, the devils amongst men, they start working hard.
وفي نهار رمضان يأتيك تمثيليات وسميها هؤلاء الشياطين بالتمثيليات الإسلامية.
So those shayateen, those devils, they come in the days of Ramadan and they bring these movies or these Islamic cartoons.
Cartoons? أي كرتونز؟ كرتونز غير كرتونز.
أي كرت فيلم؟
نعم. هم بهذا يأتي واحد منهم من هؤلاء الممثلين يمثل دور أبو جهل وأبو لهب ودور إبليس. نعم.
So one of these actors will come in this film or program or drama or cartoon, and he'll be acting out the role of Abu Jahl, for example, or acting out the role of Iblis.
يسب الرب.
And then he comes in this form of acting, insulting Allah, insulting the Lord.
يحلف بغير الله باللات وبالعزة.
And then in terms as an actor, he'll come and he'll take an oath by other than Allah, take an oath by Allat or Uzza or false deities.
يسجد للصنم.
And as an actor, he prostrates to the idol.
يعلق الصليب.
Oh, he hangs a crucifix on himself.
يعبد النار.
He worships the fire.
يعبد إبليس.
He worships Iblis.
وما هذا؟ قال هذا تمثيل حتى ننشر دين الإسلامي.
And when we ask him, what is this? He says, this is just acting. This is just a drama so we can spread the religion of Islam.
قال عليه الصلاة والسلام ثلاث جدهن جد وهزلهن جد. يعني لو كان مازح هذا كأنه جاد. منها نسأل الله عليه السلام رد، هذا رد عن دين الله. نعم.
So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, three matters when they are done. When they are done with intent and seriousness, then they are serious and severe. And when they are done joking and light and just out of light, they are done out of joke or without intent, then they are still serious.
فيريد منا أن نشاهد هذا الكفر ونكون نسأل الله عليه السلام مثلهم. So this في نهار رمضان يجعلوا بعض الناس يكفر بالله كفر أكبر مخرج من الملة والله.
So these people in the day of Ramadan, they want us to come and sit and watch these dramas and these programs, and then that we are similar to them because we are watching them and staying there. Meaning that in the day of Ramadan, in the days of Ramadan, then he's trying his utmost for people to fall into a major form of disbelief, kufr akbar.
هل ترضى أننا نمثل بأمك وبأختك وبخالتك؟ فكيف بمن يمثل أمهات المؤمنين؟ نعم.
So would this person, this actor, would he want somebody to come and act out the life of his mother or his sister or his wife? And then how about a person who acts out the life of the mother of all of the believers?
وتدرجوا في أول الأمر مثلوا الأئمة والتابعين. نعم.
So these people, they evolved in stages. At the beginning, they used to act out the lives of the imams and some of the scholars.
ثم بعد هذا مثلوا صغار الصحابة.
And then after this, they used to act out the lives of the younger companions. They used to act out the younger companions.
ثم كبار الصحابة أمهات المؤمنين.
And then after this, the next step is that they started acting out the made the older scholars and some of the mothers of the believers, i.e. the wives of the Prophet
ثم بعض الأنبياء والرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام.
And then after this, some of the messengers and the prophets.
ثم بعد هذا مثلوا كل الأنبياء والرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام.
Then after this, they started acting all of the messengers and the prophets.
ثم مثلوا الملائكة.
And then they started acting out the angels.
ثم حتى أنهم صنعوا تمثيليات لرب العالمين.
And now they are using doing making cartoons and dramas and films and programs about the Lord of the world.
حتى في ألعاب الأولاد الآن بلاي ستيشن يسموها عندنا. نعم. اللعبة هذه اللعبة تتدرج بك تقاتل من في الأرض ثم من في السماء ثم من على السماء. نعم.
So even now these games that the children are playing, the PlayStation games, so they start off the children, they start off with just killing people on the earth in these games, and then keep killing those in the sky, and then killing and fighting those who are above the skies.
فتوى هيئة كبار العلماء في المملكة العربية السعودية.
So a fatwa, an Islamic ruling from the committee of the major scholars in the Saudi Arabian Kingdom.
إذا كانت المسألة بينة واضحة سب للرب أو للدين أو للنبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فهذا يكفر كفر أكبر ولا تشك في كفري.
So if the issue is clear, that there is clear insulting of the Lord, of the religion, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then this person leaves the fold of Islam with kufr akbar, and there's no doubt about his kufr.
وإذا كانت المسألة محتملة وهذا الذي يقع من بعض الطلاب هدانا الله إياه. نعم.
If, however, the issue it can be like this or like that, and this is something which occurs from some of the students of knowledge, may Allah guide us and them.
بعض الطلاب هدانا الله إياه يمزح أحيانا بالأدلة من الكتاب والسنة حتى يضحك الطلاب.
So some students, they use the ayat or the evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah lightly in a joking way, so people can laugh, the other students can laugh.
فإذا كانت هذه المسألة محتملة فتوى اللجنة الدائمة أننا ننبه هذا أن هذا استهزاء فإن تاب تركنا وإلا كفرنا نسأل العافية والسلام.
So the fatwa of the major scholars in Saudi Arabia is that in this type of situation where the issue, the statement of this person when he's trying to make the people laugh with the evidences and the ayat and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if it's something that could possibly be insulting or it could possibly be mocking, or it might not be, then the fatwa of the major scholars is that we inform this person, we educate, or we tell this person, the student of knowledge. If he carries on, if he leaves it alone, then it's okay. If he carries on doing it, then it is kufr akbar.
نعم.
Then it is kufr akbar.
يا أخوانا, الله سبحانه وتعالى أنزل القرآن وأرسل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى نقف عند حدود الله. لا نجعل هذه الآيات والأحاديث نكت وسخرية واستهزاء حتى يضحك الناس.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed His book, He revealed His ayat, He sent His messenger. Why? So in order we could stop ourselves at the limits and the boundaries of the Sharia. He didn't send these ayat and that which was revealed in the book so we could use it as stories, or we could use it to make people laugh, or examples of joking and mockery.
هذا اللي ترى الآن تسمع من بعض الطلاب وترى في بعض الرسائل نرسل لك استهزاء وسخرية بالدين. استهزاء وسخرية بالكتاب بسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. يرسموا رسومات, هذه الرسومات فيها بعض الكلام على الملتزمين وعلى اللحى وعلى تقصير الثياب وعلى المساجد, وحدث ولا حرج. من الذي ينقل هذا؟ بعض الطلاب هدانا الله إياه.
So this what you see nowadays, the text messages, the messages that are going around, i.e. pictures or cartoons or depictions of something which is mocking or making a joke of something from the religion of Allah, or mocking the people who are practicing, mocking the beard, mocking the thobe being short, mocking the masajid, then what is this and who is this being spread about? This sometimes is being spread by the students of knowledge, i.e. this mocking and joking. Some of the students of knowledge.
إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت أي خافت قلوبهم. عندما يذكر الله تخاف. هذا المؤمن. وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا. وهذا الاستهزاء. نسأل الله العافية والسلام يخرجك من الإيمان بالكلية. نعم.
And Allah says in the Quran that the example of the believers is such that when Allah is mentioned, then they fear Allah. So when Allah is mentioned, then this should increase you in your fear of Allah. And when the ayat of Allah are mentioned,
إذا ذكر الله وجلت أي خافت قلوبهم.
So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, then their hearts tremble with fear.
وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمان. هذا المؤمن.
And when the ayat of Allah are recited, then it increases them in iman. So this is the example of a mu'min, a believer.
إذا كنا نحن نسخر أي بعض ممن ادعى الإسلام يسخر ويستهزئ ماذا أبقينا للمشركين والمنافقين؟
So if now those people who claim Islam and they call themselves Muslim, if they themselves are now mocking and joking it's about Islam and the rulings of Islam and the religion, then what have we left for the people of shirk and the people of disbelief?
الذي يسب الرب.
So the one who insults the Lord.
يستهزئ بآيات الله سبحانه وتعالى الشرعية كالقرآن والسنة.
Or a person who jokes and mocks the آيات of Allah in the religion like the Quran and the Sunnah.
أو الكونية يقول مثلا وقوع الحر في هذه الأيام كذا. أو وقوع البرد مثلا في هذه الأيام هذا كذا يعني سب واستهزاء. أو نعم.
Or a person who insults the universal signs of Allah. Like for example, a person who says that the war that has come at this place is like this. And he jokes about it, he mocks it, and he insults it. Or the weather or the coldness coming in this place, and then he mocks it or he insults it. Or a person who insults any prophet from amongst the prophets and the messengers.
هذا يكفر كفر أكبر ولا شك في كفره.
So this person, he disbelieves with a major form of disbelief and there's no doubt in his disbelief.
فماذا نصنع؟
So therefore, what should we do?
نقف عند حدود الله.
We stop and we limit ourselves at the boundaries of Allah.
نخاف.
We fear.
تليت علينا آيات الله سبحانه وتعالى أو أحاديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
When the آيات of Allah, when the ayat of Allah or the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are recited and narrated, then we should fear and increase in our fear.
لا ننتظر حتى نسمع السب ولا نجلس في هذه المجالس ننشر فتوى هيئة كبار العلماء في التكفير سب الرب والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والاستهزاء بالدين.
Then we shouldn't sit so we can listen to this joking and this mocking and this comedy of these things. Rather, straight away we speak against it, we reject it, we start spreading the fatwa of the major scholars.
يا أخواننا هذه المسألة مسألة مهمة جدا. في الحديث أن هذا الذي تكلم على النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام والصحابة رضوان الله عليهم خرج مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في تبوك. نعم.
So this is a very serious matter. In the hadith,
في الحديث أن هذا الذي حصل منه الكلام على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والصحابة رضي الله عليهم جاهد مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في تبوك خرج مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في تبوك.
So in the hadith in which this mockery or this joke it came from this person, then this person who was joking or mocking or making comedy out of it, then he was one of the people who went out to Tabuk and he fought jihad with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
خرج مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى تبوك ثم بعد هذا تكلم على النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام والصحابة رضي الله عليهم.
So this person, he went out in order to fight jihad in Tabuk with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then after this, then he started making, then he started joking or making a mockery of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions.
يقول ابن القيم رحمه الله.
So Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله said,
إن الحسنة قد تدخل النار.
That sometimes a good deed might enter a person into the fire.
والسيئة قد تدخل الجنة.
And sometimes a bad deed might enter a person into paradise.
الحسنة قد تدخل النار. هذا جاهد مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم واقتر بهذا نسأل الله العافية السلامة ثم كان بهذا أي بعد الحسنة عندما اقتر كان كافرا كفر كفرا أكبر مخرج من ملة نسأل الله العافية السلامة.
So this person, he did a good deed. I, he went and he fought jihad. However, he became deceived by this. And when he came, became deceived by his good deed, then this entered him into the fire. Why? Because he became a kafir, a disbeliever with a major form of disbelief.
كذلك السيئة قد تدخل الجنة.
And also, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, sometimes a bad deed might enter somebody into paradise.
يذنب ذنب.
A person, he does a bad deed.
ثم يتذكر هذا الذنب ويتوب منه ويتصدق ويصلي ويصنع عبادات كثيرة وهو دائما ينظر إلى هذا الذنب نصب عينيه كأنه جبل يكاد يسقط عليه فكان هذا الذنب سبب لدخوله في الجنة.
So this person who does this bad deed, because of doing this evil action, this bad deed, he then repents to Allah. He seeks forgiveness. He does good deeds. He then starts giving in charity, worshipping Allah. And he always remembers and thinks about that bad deed or that evil action he does. It's as if the evil action is right in front of his eyes. Or it's as if that bad deed or those, that evil action that he committed is like a mountain on top of his head.
هذا ويعني لابد أن يراجع هذا الباب في شرح الشيخ بن عثيمين رحمه الله تعالى في القول المفيد لأنه ذكر أكثر من هذا. ذكر أن الساب للرب سبحانه وتعالى في خلاف بين العلماء هل تقبل توبته أم لا.
So this chapter, you need to go and read it in the explanation of Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah called Al-Qawl Al-Mufid, and it's available in English. Because Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, he mentions more instances or more rulings regarding this. The scholars have differed that the person who insults the Lord, insults Allah, even if he repents, is his repentance accepted or not?
وفي ساب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى ولو قلنا بأنه تقبل توبته قال هذا يقتل نسأل الله عافية السلام لكن من السلطان لا منا نعم.
And as for insulting the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, even if he repents, then he is to be killed. However, this killing or this punishment is carried out by the rule or the leader, not by the normal people.
نعم والله أعلم وصلى الله على النبي محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.